Hello, and welcome to our online service of worship. My name is Adrian Gundy, and I welcome you on behalf of Glenburn Methodist Church here in Belfast, Northern Ireland. You are most welcome. We trust and pray that your time with us will be one of blessing. The theme of our online service of worship this Sunday is No Condemnation, as we continue looking at Max Lucado's book, Unshakable Hope. Let us read some words of encouragement and welcome from the psalm, reading Psalm 25, reading from verse 12. Who then are those who fear the Lord? He will instruct them in the ways they should choose. They will spend their days in prosperity, and their descendants will inherit the land. The Lord confides in those who fear him. He makes his covenant known to them. My eyes are ever on the Lord, for only he will release my feet from the snare. I really like some of the readings from the Psalms. They're poetic and yet carry essential and eternal truths. We'll refer to this psalm later on as we reflect on what God has to say to us in his word to us. But for now, let us continue to worship, and we invite you to join and sing as we move into a time of praise and song. Let us praise God together.
Jesus, we enthrone you. We proclaim you our King. Standing here in the midst of us, we raise you up with our praise. And as we worship in the throne, and as we worship as we worship, build a throne. Come, Lord Jesus, and take your place. Jesus, we enthrone you. We proclaim you are King. Enthrone you.
Jesus Christ. We welcome you.
Our prayers of approach, of confession and thanksgiving. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we give you thanks. Always and everywhere and at all times, it is right to give you thanks. And we thank you. We thank you for this new day, for this new week, for life in all its fullness. We thank you, Lord, for your blessing to us. For the many gifts and blessings that we enjoy, for the comforts of life, for family and for friends, for love and for kindness, for comfort, for homes, for food, for work, for money, for leisure time, for hobbies, for sport. Oh Lord, we have so much to be thankful for. And Lord, we think and say thanks for this awful time that we've had these last almost 2 years now, with so much pain and suffering for so many people, such disruption, such sadness. And Lord, we seem to be now coming out of this period of suffering, and it's starting to ease. And so Lord, we give you thanks. Thanks, Lord, that we are able to begin to live life again, anew and afresh. And we say thank you. Lord, might be mindful with us that
times are still strange, we still have to be careful, but we are beginning to enjoy the restoration of our freedom. Lord, starting to do the things that we used to do. There's so much to be thankful for. And Lord, as we reflect on your kindness and your goodness and your blessing to us, we are so mindful of the things that we have done that have let you down, the words that we have spoken that have hurt and criticized, the thoughts that we have spoken that have sullied your name, the actions and deeds that we have done that have been unkind and unfair and have brought pain and suffering to the people so often that we love. And Lord, we say sorry. We say sorry to you. Sorry for all those times when our behavior, our words, our thoughts let you down. We ask you to forgive us, Lord, not because of us, but because of the love of Jesus. And so, Lord, we ask you to forgive us our sin in the name of Jesus. Forgive us, Lord, for we are truly sorry and repent of all our wrongdoing. And in these moments now, as we confess to you in the name of Jesus our sin and wrongdoing, we can know the forgiveness that Jesus, that only Jesus brings, the forgiveness of sins, the life new, restored, life everlasting in and through the name of Jesus. Lord, it's just a wonderful mystery, such a wonderful privilege to know Jesus and to know that we are accepted, we are forgiven, we are loved, we are restored, we are encouraged, we are lifted up, and Lord, we are blessed. And all this made possible in and through the name of Jesus, the Jesus who taught us to say, Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Amen. The Old Testament reading, Joshua chapter 1, verses 7 to 9. This is the word of God. Be strong and very courageous. Be careful to obey all the law my servant Moses gave you. Do not turn from it to the right or to the left, that you may be successful wherever you go. Keep this book of the law always on your lips. Meditate on it day and night, so that you may be careful to do everything written in it. Then you will be prosperous and successful. Have I not commanded you? Be strong and courageous. Do not be afraid. Do not be discouraged, for the Lord your God will be with you wherever you go. Amen. The New Testament reading from the Gospel according to St. John, chapter 8, and reading from verse 31. This is the word of the Lord. To the Jews who had believed him, Jesus said, "If you hold to my teaching, you are really my disciples, and then you will know the truth, and the truth will set you free." They answered him, "We are Abraham's descendants and have never been slaves of anyone. How can you say that we shall be set free?" Jesus replied, "Very truly I tell you, everyone who sins is a slave to sin. Now a slave has no permanent place in the family, but a son belongs to it forever. So if the Son sets you free, you will be free indeed. I know that you are Abraham's descendants, yet you are looking for a way to kill me, because you have no room for my word. I am telling you what I have seen in the Father's presence, and you are doing what you have heard from your Father." Amen.
I wonder if you would pray with me, please. May the words of my mouth and the thoughts and meditations of all our minds and hearts be acceptable in your sight. Amen. Amen. Well, we are continuing to live in strange times, aren't we? And 18 months now, and we seem to be moving towards coming out of this pandemic. We still have concerns, but there are signs that we're moving back towards some kind of normality, and we trust and pray that this will continue. However, that said, I think it's fair to say now that we are beginning to see other changes that are taking place, particularly in the Western world, particularly in Western democracies and society, certainly within the UK and Ireland. We're part of that as well, and we see it as well. And it seems that the old Judeo-Christian values and established way of living and working, the moral compass, if you will, that a Christian tradition or heritage has brought many of the Western countries, is now being eroded at a fast pace. And the Christian values that were seemingly accepted and embedded in the fabric of society as a way of living, of a way the nations, the communities work together, whether or not people believed in God, whether or not people believed in Jesus, nonetheless, we seem to have had over several hundreds of years these Judeo-Christian values and morality, which acted as a break, as a filter for society, as a comparison against which we could judge behaviors, make decisions and policies. And there was a sense in doing the right thing because the right thing's right to do. And all this now is changing really quickly. And what was accepted as the right thing to do in the right moment, because it's the right thing to do, is now being cast aside, and a new set of values is coming in, and a new way of looking at life. And it's quite challenging for those of us who believe in the gospel of Jesus Christ. And it's against this backdrop that we are living and witnessing as Christians and followers of Jesus. And the passage that I have chosen is one that I've used before. I believe it is a picture of today, of exactly what's going on today. And I'd like to spend some time dwelling upon that to see how God would speak to us through this reading of his word. But first, of course, I'd like to refer to our Old Testament reading, which came from the book of Joshua. You'll recall that they are wonderful words of encouragement. Be strong and very courageous. Be careful to obey the law my servant Moses gave you. Do not turn from it to the left or to the right, that you may be successful wherever you go. Keep this book of the law on your lips. Meditate on it day and night, so that you may be careful to do everything written in it. And then you will be prosperous and successful. Be strong. Be courageous. Do not be afraid. Do not be discouraged. For the Lord your God will be with you wherever you go. Wonderful words of encouragement. And so often in the Old Testament, we'll find these words of encouragement. But it is a bit of a statement. And there are times when we reflect on it as people living in today's age, just how we might do some of this stuff. It's one thing to say, be strong and be courageous. It's another thing to be able to be strong and be courageous in a world which is changing so fast and changing in a way which is in a way which we really don't value, in which it's not helpful, it's not what we've been brought up with, and it's quite challenging. In this reading from John, I believe we have a picture of today. Jesus is talking with some Jews and he's having a conversation with them. And as we listen to the words of Jesus speak to the Jews in this context, we'll get a sense of what he's saying and how it applies to today. Jesus said to these Jews, "If you hold to my teaching, you are really my disciples. Then you will know the truth, and the truth will set you free." My teaching, the teaching of Jesus. If you follow the teaching of Jesus, then you will know the truth, and the truth will set you free. So there's our first little insight that Jesus is telling the people of his day, that if you follow my teaching, then you will be free. And that's a pointer for us in today's age, in this era of change, to follow the teaching of Jesus. But then the Jews countered and they answered him back. They said, "We are Abraham's descendants and have never been slaves of anyone. How can you say that we shall be set free?" It's a paraphrase, isn't it, of the response that people give us today when we talk about the teaching of Jesus being the truth and the truth will setting us free. People will say to us, "I don't need to be set free. I'm not a slave. I'm not a slave of sin. I don't buy into all of that." And as a consequence, they deny it. So Jesus' reply is this: "Very truly, I tell you, everyone who sins is a slave to sin. You do wrong, you're a slave to doing wrong." Then he goes on to say, "Now a slave has no permanent place in the family, but a son belongs to it forever. So if the son sets you free, you will be free indeed." He's talking, it's a picture about the son of God being Jesus. If Jesus sets you free, then you will be free indeed. So we now have a second truth. The first one, if we believe and meditate upon the teachings of Jesus, we will know the truth, and the truth will set us free. And if we follow Jesus and trust in him, then he will set us free. And then further, Jesus goes on to really put the Jews in a challenge with his next statement. For he goes on to say, "I know that you are Abraham's descendants, yet you are looking for a way to kill me, because you have no room for my word." Now, isn't that a picture of today? As we share our testimony, as we share and witness to the person and the gospel of Jesus, people don't believe us. They have no room for this, no room for this belief, no room for Jesus, no room for his word. Furthermore, Jesus says, "I am telling you the truth. What I have seen in the Father's presence, and you are doing what you have heard from your father." To which the Jews replied, "Abraham is our father, not you." This is what we hear today with the people who are changing everything, who are outside the kingdom, who do not believe and accept. As a consequence, they're saying, "He's not our father. God's not our God. Jesus is not ours." Furthermore, Jesus condemns them with these words: If you were Abraham's children, then you would do what Abraham did. As it is, you are looking for a way to kill me, a man who has told you the truth that I heard from God. Abraham did not do such things. You are doing the works of your own father. You are doing the works of your own father. The devil himself, the master of lies. If you were to read that chapter into the next few verses, Jesus spells it out in even more detail. And as we look around at the changes, as we look around to the undervaluing and the undermining of Christian morals and the values that we hold dear, the very presence and nature of God, the very presence and personality of Jesus, the Son of God, the very message of the gospel message, we're hearing people say, I don't believe. There's no place for that. You can't say these things. And we find ourselves as Christians being caught up in a situation where even to believe and to have this opinion about Jesus and to witness to him creates problems and issues and challenges. And who knows how far these changes will continue to go. And so it's easy for people to get confused, to be misinformed, to listen to what's going on and not really be able to establish the truth of it all. As a believer in Christ, we believe in the words written and contained for us in the Holy Scriptures, the Holy Bible. And if we know the truth that's in the Bible, the truth will set us free. And if we know Jesus and follow Jesus, then he will set us free. So how do we overcome this misinformation? How do we overcome the challenge of people challenging our beliefs, refusing to believe, refusing even to consider? By dwelling on the word, his word, and following Jesus. Now, this is an address that is part of a series of online services as we follow the book Max Lucado, talking about unshakable hope. And in the chapter that we're referencing in this one, it's talking about no condemnation. And I've used this passage before and other online services as we've explored the response that as believers in Christ that we would have to what we see around about us as the world changes at such an immense rate. And how having an understanding of the truth of the scriptures, how it points us towards appropriate responses in how we deal with it and how we respond to it. But in Max Lucado's book, on this chapter that we're looking at this weekend, he is particularly focusing on the idea of there is no condemnation for a believer in Jesus. For Jesus sets us free. The Son sets us free. How does he do this? We come to him and we accept that we are sinners. We confess and repent of our sin. And we put our whole trust in Jesus. And in return, Jesus mediates with God and our sin is forgiven. We are given a fresh start. Our past is put behind us. There is no condemnation. We are truly forgiven and free, free from sin, free from all the things that we have done and participated in that were not good, because we have confessed and repented of these in Jesus' name. And in addition to this sense of freedom, God sends his Holy Spirit to live within us where we do become truly free. And so our lives start this change process, which ultimately becomes a transformation process. And we finish in a position where that transformation process is completed when we pass on this earth and we meet with our Heavenly Father face to face. And in that judgment time, we are then made perfect and we enter into the kingdom of heaven for all eternity. There is no condemnation. Now you compare that hope, that message, that truth of freedom and no condemnation with what we see around about us as the world changes. Perhaps it's best summed up with the phrase cancel culture, where it has become an evident truth of today's change that you are, if a group of people don't like what you're saying, do not like your opinion, or if you've said something in the past that perhaps wasn't a particularly nice or truthful thing to say, you find yourself getting cancelled. And it's easy for people just to say, oh, I shall brush away, it's not important, who are they? They're anonymous people. But it has very real implications for a lot of people. People are beginning to lose their livelihoods. People are beginning to lose their sources of income. They're beginning to lose their place in society. They're beginning to lose their position that they hold, the respect that they would have. They're being cancelled. We see time and time again instances of writers, of authors, of books, of songs, of politicians, of sports people, of celebrities, of people in the public eye getting cancelled, where what they have done is now deemed as inappropriate and is now thought of as wrong and as a consequence needs to be removed. Wow, what a situation to find yourself in, where in your day and age you wrote something which was generally accepted, and then all of a sudden now people years later are now judging that in a different context, and as a consequence we find people being banished, being condemned, being cancelled. No forgiveness, no second chance. Banned, cancelled, removed. This can't be the way society was designed to function. For none of us are free from sin. We have all sinned and fallen short of the glory of God, have we not? No one is perfect, not one of us. And so this approach to cancelling people, to condemning them for what they have said or what they have believed or what they have done or what they have written historically or even in today's age is now all of a sudden unforgivable. As a believer in Jesus, as a follower of the truth, as we believe it and understand it to be as revealed in Jesus, through his work, his life, his death, his resurrection, and the words and the stories and the witness we find in the Holy Scriptures, this truth as we understand it, as we believe it, we have a second chance. No one is condemned ultimately except by their own decision. There isn't a group of people sitting in judgment that says, you're cancelled. It's the idea of being able to come to God in humility, in the name of Jesus, and acknowledge that we're not perfect, and seek forgiveness through repentance of that imperfection. And when we do that, we then know the truth, and the truth sets us free. For the Son, Jesus, forgives us, and we are sensing and tasting a new freedom, a second chance, a new life. No cancellation, no condemnation, no banishment, no removal from society. A new a new start, a new beginning. This is what is available to us today. I'm not sure, as this service goes across the airwaves, at what day or time of the day you may be listening to this address as part of this act of worship. But this invitation to come before Jesus, to seek his forgiveness and to be restored and renewed and uplifted and set free and changed and transformed into the kind of person that God wanted you to be when he created us, is available at any time. You don't have to listen to this broadcast to be able to have this opportunity, but as you listen to it now, whatever date or day or time of the day or whatever place you find yourself, this invitation still holds true, for the truth will set you free. And so I would encourage you to consider and reflect on these words. So this passage from John, I believe, is a picture. Jesus is talking to the Jews of his time, the Jews that did not believe and wanted to kill Jesus. And I believe this is a picture of how we find ourselves in today's age, as we look around at everything that's changing. And as believers in Jesus, we find ourselves more marginalized and more pushed to the side. We have a response, for the truth will set you free. And the Son will set you free. And if the Son sets you free, you are free indeed. And there's nothing anybody else can do to cancel you. We have that wonderful sense of God's presence in our lives. No condemnation. Wonderful message. I trust and pray that you will reflect on this. And perhaps if you are not yet a believer, you might come to that space, to that place in time where you come before God and seek his forgiveness in Jesus, and you enjoy this new start, this new life, this second chance, this new beginning, life in all its fullness. For if the Son sets you free, you are free indeed. Amen. When followers of Jesus get together, they would always spend time praying for others and for their needs. For we believe that God meets with people and supplies their needs. And so we invite you now to join with us as believers in Christ, coming together to pray in the name of Jesus for the needs of people who need his healing touch. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, in these moments now, we pause to reflect on the needs of people. First of all, Lord, we pray for those people whom we know, whom we are acquainted with, who are our friends, who are members of our family, our extended families, people who are at this moment in time outside the kingdom, people who have perhaps heard the gospel message of Jesus but have not yet believed, or maybe for those people who have not had the opportunity of hearing the gospel message, and so because they have not heard, how can they believe? Lord, we pray for these people now. We pray, Lord, that you would send a messenger, that people would go, would share the gospel message with those people who have not believed. Lord, we pray that your Spirit would go before, preparing their minds and hearts to receive the word. And when the message is shared, they might consider this message, take it into their heart, believe and be saved. And Lord, we pray for those people whom we know who are in need of saving, who are outside the kingdom. Lord, we pray that they would hear, they would believe and be saved for all eternity. Lord, we pray for those people who are in need of healing. We know, Lord, that healing comes in many different ways. Healing of both the physical body, the mind, the spirituality, the soul of people, in relationships, in peace of mind, in mental and relationships, and all sorts of different ways of healing. Lord, we pray for people now, people who need the touch of your healing hand upon their lives. We pray, Lord, we pray that you would bring your spirit of healing to meet their need, whatever it be. Lord, we think of these people now. We can picture them in our mind's eye. We bring them to you. We hand them over to you. And we ask you to bless them in Jesus' name and to heal them in Jesus' name. All this, Lord, for the glory of Jesus. And so, Lord, we pray for healing. And Lord, we pray for this wider world. We pray for all those people who are struggling, who are finding life difficult. We've had 18 months or so of a real challenge of fear, of a pandemic, of a changing in lifestyle, of a withdrawal of freedoms, and all sorts of changes. And it's made us as a people quite fearful, losing our confidence. And Lord, as we come out of this now, as we start to return to more normal ways of living, as we still start to explore what it's like to live with the pandemic, we pray, Lord, for the wider world. We pray for those people who are still fearful. We pray for those people who are still suffering because of these changing circumstances in which the world finds itself living. Lord, we pray for the believers in Jesus. We pray for the Christian church across this world. We pray for those believers who are persecuted because of their belief in Jesus. Lord, we pray for them. We pray a hedge of protection around them. They are brothers and sisters in Christ, and we stand with them shoulder to shoulder. Lord, bless them. Bless them with courage. Bless them with reassurance. Bless them with an uplifting that they witness to you, and you are with them, and we are with them also. Lord, these are our prayers, but some of our prayers. We bring all these prayers and more, both spoken and felt and thought, from the very innermost parts of our mind and hearts. We bring all our prayers to you. We bring them in the name of Jesus. We ask you to consider them and to grant them, all for the glory of God in through Jesus. Amen.
stands in victory, since curse has lost its grip on thee.
For I am his, and he is mine, bought with the precious blood of Christ. No guilt in life, no fear in death, this is the marvel of Christ in me. From life's first cry to final breath, Jesus commands my destiny.